Science Uncut, presented by the Volkswagen Foundation.
What I would like to present is a project between indigenous and scientific partners. In July last year, with the kind support of the Volkswagen Foundation, we invited four indigenous guests from MeToo at the Rio Vaupés to the Ethnological Museum in Berlin. Diana Guzman, Maria Morera, Gaudencio Moreno, and Orlando Villegas. Well, most of you will know Berlin, but maybe not the Amazon. The Rio Vaupés is a river that crosses the border region between Colombia and Brazil, and MeToo is a small capital of the Colombian Vaupés state. I say we because the organization of the project was a joint undertaking between Ingrid Krummels of the Free University of Berlin, Ernst Halbmeier of Marburg University, Richard Haas from the Ethnological Museum in Berlin, and myself. The meeting in Berlin consisted of two parts. A closed workshop where we talked about the museum's collections, and a public conference where all of us, anthropologists and indigenous guests, presented papers about their experiences and their work. And what I would like to share with you in the next 14, 15 minutes is not the knowledge that we had about a specific object before and after the meeting. My goal here is to give you an impression of what the meeting meant, and most of all, how our indigenous partners structured it according to their cultural traditions. Before I describe what happened in Berlin, I will briefly provide some background on the collection, the project history, and the Tucanoan cosmovision. In 1905, the Ethnological Museum of Berlin received a collection of about 1,300 objects from the Upper Rio Negro. The objects had been collected by Theodor Koch-Grünberg of the museum staff. For 2 years, he traveled through the Amazon region, establishing good relationships with the communities he visited and paying for the objects and the services he received. Approximately 400 objects he sold to the Museo Goeldi in Belém while he was still in Brazil. Only 4 years later, another German traveler by the name of Hermann Schmidt visited not only the same region, but even some of the same villages. He also collected indigenous objects that now belong to the American Museum of Natural History in New York, as well as the Linden Museum in Stuttgart. Although Schmidt never published anything, he describes in some archived letters how some villages had been burned down by rubber tappers entering the region, villages visited by Koch-Grünberg a few years earlier. And this means that the objects in Berlin were collected at the exact time when the situation for the indigenous societies in the Upper Rio Negro was getting worse. Missionaries entered the region a few years later, although they didn't kill people, they continued to destroy material goods, mostly religious objects. The cooperation project has different origins. Some years ago, I worked on a research project about the legacy of Theodor Koch-Grünberg, and in 2010, a Colombian colleague, Roberto Pineda, took me to MeToo and introduced me to Diana Guzman and Orlando Villegas. Diana and Orlando belong to different ethnic groups which share the Tucanoan language family. Both are school teachers at a secondary school in MeToo. Both received the title of Vigía del Patrimonio, Custodian of Cultural Heritage, an honorary title awarded by the Colombian authorities to people who are highly engaged in conserving their cultural traditions. And importantly for us, Diana is also responsible for a small museum belonging to the school, which does not get too much support, as you may imagine. In their work as school teachers, both fight for inclusion of more elements of indigenous knowledge in the official curriculum. Well, one of the complaints anthropologists are used to hearing is that the results of scientific endeavors don't flow back to their places of origin. And this was, in broad terms, the starting point of our project. If they want to know what we have and what we do, it is important to invite them to our part of the world. Well, now, In a sense, I have to apologize. I have a problem. Of course, it is impossible to introduce the ethnography of an Amazonian people in 3 minutes. But if we wish to understand what happened during the Berlin meeting, we have to be aware of some basic elements of Tucanoan culture. And first of all, objects played an important role in the creation myths of these groups. The most important objects are the stool, the cigar and the cigar holder, the god on a stand, and the ceremonial staff. From a very long story, I would like to show you only three very short extracts. At the very beginning, the grandmother of the universe used some of these objects to start mankind's creation process. Later, the grandfather of the world handed over certain objects to the creator of the world, which he used to create the future mankind. Here on the right side of the second drawing, you can see the feather box which stored the most important objects for rituals. And the different ethnic groups gained territory by traveling in a large anaconda boat. The journey was a kind of gestation where people transformed into human beings inside the anaconda boat. When each ethnic group disembarked, they marked the place where they landed with their specific ceremonial staff and built a maloka. A maloka is a traditional longhouse which the Tucano originally lived in. The house was a village and was inhabited by between 25 and 100 people. The owner of the maloka had a feather box hanging traditionally under the roof, which contained the most important ritual objects. Today, only few Tucano live in malokas, but they are still built as a symbol of indigenous identity and as a place for meetings, rituals, and feasts. One of the most important aspects is that the same physical element can have many different meanings according to the specific occasion. At first sight, a door is a door, a roof is a roof, a pole is a pole, a beer trough is a beer trough. That being said, during specific rituals, the maloka represents not the house, but the cosmos. Then a pole is perceived as a mountain, the roof as a sky, and the beer trough represents a mythical anaconda boat. At another time, the house is imagined as a female body. The end is her head, the front door is a vagina, and the cavernous interior is a womb. Thus, people inside the house can be inside a house, but they can also perceive themselves as being inside the anaconda boat or inside a womb. Both are related to the process of gestation and giving birth to a child, to society, or to the whole of mankind. So it's even more complicated. You can read the maloka also as a male body. It's not the time to explain this here. What I try to explain is that, in a sense, you can compare a maloka with a theater stage. The same object in the same place inside has a different meaning depending on the piece you play. So, what happened in Berlin? Of course, we had developed a working plan and spread out the objects on large tables in the depot with the help of the museum's conservators and restorers. The interesting point for us was that our indigenous guests told us from the beginning that when we talked about objects, we had to do so in the right way. And this meant that we shouldn't start with questions about material, function, the symbolism of ornaments or whatever, but with the creation of everything. Then they built groups of objects corresponding to their appearance in the creation myth. Firstly, they grouped the ceremonial staff, the cigar holder, and the cigar. We had to bring these objects into a different room because they told us that with so many still powerful artifacts, they didn't want to be in the depot for the whole day. And then Don Gaudencio started to tell the myth and explain the meaning of the objects within that context. Many times he spoke in his language, and Orlando translated for us into Spanish. So in the morning sessions, we listened to their stories and asked questions. To be honest, after hours of listening, most of us were a little exhausted, and in the afternoons, we typically discussed simpler topics. At the start of every day, our guests painted their faces. One day, all of us had to be painted. This wasn't for show. Rather, it corresponded to indigenous life in the Amazon. Body decoration can have different meanings. It can be done for protection, and that was the reason why they painted themselves every day before entering the depot. According to the Tucanoan worldview, some of the objects are believed to be people and remain powerful. But body decoration can also be a sign of joy and delight. So on the day when we talked about music, dances, feasts, and body jewelry objects, they insisted that all of us had to be painted in order to be well-dressed for that specific occasion. We also had to respect the gender segregation that exists in indigenous societies. We knew that there were holy flutes in the collection that shouldn't be seen by women. We asked the men beforehand how we should behave. They answered that Diana and Maria were old enough to enter the room, as they had already given life to their children. The two women, however, didn't cross the point in the depot where they knew that the flutes were stored. That means they transferred the spatial order of the maloca to the museum depot. The day we talked about the flutes, we had to build two groups. Men were allowed to enter the room where the flutes were shelved, while women talked about different topics in another room. At the end of the conference, our guests introduced another element, which I mentioned before. When we concluded, they asked us, the organizers of the event, to stand in the middle of the conference room. Then they went outside and after a short moment came in again, running, singing and shouting. We hadn't been informed before that this would happen. They circled around us and in the end presented some gifts that they had brought from me too. Even though it wasn't food, which is traditionally exchanged, but handicrafts, it was obvious they were enacting a kind of dabukuri, the ritual gift exchange between residents of different malokas that is important in establishing or confirming social relationships. Well, the whole event was very inspiring, but there were also some difficult moments. As I said, the owner and chief of a maloka conserves the most important ritual objects in the feather box. Our guests told us that these objects are the spinal column of a community. Koch Grünberg and other anthropologists of the time hadn't known this. It was a real shock for our guests that in former times museum officials used to exchange parts of the feather box with other museums. You should not split a spinal column. They compared this behavior with the quartering of a human being. There was another difficult moment that we hadn't foreseen. Some things are so obvious to us that we don't even think about them anymore. We invited some colleagues to the conference who were familiar with the collections in Belém, Stuttgart, and New York. The idea was to compare the collections from that period and also to provide our guests with some information about the collections of other museums. What we hadn't properly considered was that the sheer amount of museums and collections that exist is very familiar to us, but not to our guests. This caused discomfort, and I was told that they had been prepared to see many things from their own culture in Berlin, but they hadn't been aware that there were so many things in so many different places in the world, so much more than they know from their own experiences at home. Well, in conclusion, my opinion is that this kind of personal meeting and collaboration in a museum is absolutely enriching for both sides. Of course, we learned a lot about specific objects and aspects that I have neglected here because of time constraints. Most of all, we were very impressed with how our guests transferred the order of a Tucanoan maloka into the museum. And they learned about the enormous amount of objects that exist, or better, that live in remote places. They saw and touched the objects produced by their ancestors and learned about our interests, our ways of using objects, and our conservation methods. We talk and write about our experiences, and they spread the information they gained in their school and village. Of course, they also recorded and photographed the meeting. Most of our time was harmonious and pleasant. That being said, some discoveries were surprising and some even hurtful. A true dialogue includes these points. The staff and the advisory boards of our museums are very international these days, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they are really in touch with the people whose ancestors produced the objects that we exhibit. Connecting with these people, their perspectives and realities should be a key task for museum project. So I hope there will be more projects including indigenous people not only in our field work, but also in our museum work. Thank you very much.